Good afternoon to you all, sir. Thank you, sir.
Well, what a very interesting name. What does Renge and Raja Babu Bau mean?
Sir, Renge is my surname and Raja Babu is my father's name. Whereas Arvind is my name.
Okay. Yes. Is there any significance for Raja Babu or?
Sir, Bau in Marathi means some yeller. So usually people add some Bau or Rao or Dada as affix to, suffix to their names. Sir. So it's kind of that way.
Okay. You have written that you enjoy traveling by trains.
Yes.
Tell us about your experience.
Sir, the major reason why I like traveling by trains is because it provides an unmatchable opportunity to meet people from various cross sections of society. And it's a nation in miniature, sir. So it's the most important thing is we get to explore nation without traversing all the corners of nation. And in that way, sir, apart from this, the very exposure it provides to traverse long distance in a smooth way is different in itself, sir.
You also enjoy the scenery and the landscape.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Which are your memorable journeys?
Sir, one is Dibrugarh to Manmad. It was the longest train journey. Another one was from Lamding to Silchar in Assam. Then Madgaon to Kochi via Konkan Railway.
So what did you find something distinct as an experience in Konkan Railway?
Sir, Konkan Railway, apart from the obvious scenery, the beautiful landscape of Western Ghats, the most important thing is it is a marvel, engineering marvel in itself, because it was one of the most difficult terrain for Indian Railways to build, and that way it's a kind of pride for India as itself. Apart from that, people from different parts of India were traveling together, so it was a good memorable experience.
For the Konkan Railway project, would you give the credit to somebody for achieving credit for that?
Yes, sir.
Whom would you give that
credit? Mr. Sridharan, sir. He was a pioneer, and major credit goes to him because of the relentless efforts and planning which he and his team put in, sir.
What is so special about Sridharan? Because of his engineering skills or management skills?
Sir, with addition to his inherent advantage of being an insider in railways and engineering field, the more important thing is management and the decisiveness in his decisions. He wanted, apart from Konkan Railway, in Delhi Metro also, the decisiveness and the way they the team conquered the challenges which they faced was really appreciable, sir.
Are you in favor of having more technocrats in administrative government functioning?
Sir, yes, technocrats have the benefits of their own. But having said that, sir, it should be a judicious mix of technocrats as well as generalists, sir. Because technocrats bring in an element of expertise and specialization in their skills. But at the same time, administration in itself is covers a large horizon and a large landscape. So it has to be a judicious mix wherein technocrats as well as generalists work together as a team, sir.
The government proposed some time back that there should be lateral entry for experts.
Yes.
What's your take on that?
Sir, it's a welcome move because it will bring expertise and experience from private sector as well as different walks of life, because that is needed to bring in fresh ideas in government working as well as their own experience and their own innovative ideas will be there, which can help in not only changing the way we work in government But at the same time, it will change the business processes and bring in more efficiency, which will be like win-win situation for both.
You are from Maharashtra.
Yes.
Maharashtra, the agriculture sector has something distinct from the other states. Can you tell us about the agriculture in Maharashtra, and what it is, and what are the challenges and prospects?
Sir, agriculture in Maharashtra is predominantly like dominated by crops like sugarcane, cotton, wheat and jowar. But at the same time, although the productivity is increasing, but at the same time, there is large disparity across the regions in Maharashtra. And because of agrarian distress in regions like Marathwada and Vidarbha, there are numerous challenges like lack of adequate irrigation. Only 18% of Maharashtra's agriculture is irrigated. Lack of adequate remunerative prices which the farmers get, lack of adequate procurement, and lack of adequate institutional credit. All these factors cumulatively lead to agrarian distress and unfortunate instances of farmer suicide, sir.
Thank you.
Why Maratha is stressed?
Sir, again, numerous factors like being on the rain shadow region of Western Ghats, it receives less rainfall, so it is monsoon dependent as well as lack of adequate irrigation.
Fair enough. What is soil health card?
It is a card which is given after analysis of nutrients and nutrient components in a soil, in particular sample of soil, so that that's the nutrients which can be applied, the content as well as proportionate quantum of the nutrients to be applied can be gauged by analyzing the samples of soils.
Okay, you are working in CBDD since 2014,
yes.
Almost 4.5 years. So, why you wish to shift now?
Sorry, sir.
Why you wish to shift now?
Sir, actually it's not the push factor that I don't want to leave this job and go to IPS. But at the same time, I am happy in CBDT. I am working and I am enjoying working there, sir. But at the same time, sir, the vast exposure, dynamic challenges and the field level experience which IPS will provide me is not there, because in IRS it's more of a test job. We deal with only around 5 to 6% of population that too relatively well off. Whereas in a police service, I'll be getting an opportunity to serve people from all the sections of society. At the same time, I'll be deriving pleasure, satisfaction of having done direct intervention in their day-to-day problems, and that will be, sir, an
anchor. Okay. Can a country like India, can we do away with direct access?
I would beg to differ with you, sir, because in fact we should be moving towards direct taxes and minimizing or eliminating indirect taxes, because direct taxes are progressive in nature, whereas indirect taxes hamper common man as well as riches almost equally.
So can you give an example of tax structure of Dubai? They are so highly regulated despite being scarcity of resources. So can you elaborate about the tax structure?
Sorry sir, I am not aware of it.
Okay, fair enough. Is it appropriate time to tax agriculture income?
Sir, it would be like not appropriate to tax entire agriculture income. Even now we have a component of agricultural income included in total income of a person. But at the same time, we need to think and have deliberations as to the ways and the means to tax the relatively well-off sections of agriculture. Because agriculture income is being misused by relatively well-off people to evade taxes by claiming exemptions.
Exactly, especially in Punjab and Haryana, there are farmers whose income is more than 1 crore, and they are exempted from agriculture taxation.
Yes, sir. That is an anomaly which we need to plug in very soon, sir.
Okay. Recently, you heard of some Sabarimala protests.
Yes.
What were they about, and what is your understanding of the actual situation as far as the Supreme Court is concerned?
Sir, it was mainly dealt with the demand by sections of population to have women's entry into temple premises, too, and the opposition by other sections of population which are against women's entry due to religious reasons, which they claim as deity being cerebral. They claim that it's ritually being followed since ages, that women of menstrual age are not allowed entry into the temple. Supreme Court recently gave a judgment wherein it ordered state government to allow women of all the ages to have entry into the temple. But again, there is a significant opposition from sections of populations.
What is your take?
Sir, with due respect to religious sentiments of people, the religious sentiments have to adapt and keep themselves with the changing times. And no religion in the world can distinguish between its followers, and not at all on the grounds of gender, sir. So, temple entry to women is like a basic human right.
Basic human rights.
Yes.
Okay. Now, a similar question in a secular country like Kumbh Mela.
Yes.
It signifies, glorifies a particular religion, thoughts, feelings, and views. How far do you think it is good that the state sponsors and facilitates such an organization?
Sir, our constitution provides for equal support to all the religions. So, it's not that it is supporting only one particular religion. But at the same time, it should be done judiciously, that resources should not be overspent on certain events. And it should not be glorifying one religion at the cost of other. As long as we are supporting all the religions, and not discriminating between the religions, state support is not harmful in much ways.
Can you name any other similar or organized mela from other religions which the governments are supporting?
Sir, Hajj pilgrimage is being was being supported by government.
Was being?
Yes.
It is not being done.
But from the sections of Muslim population itself, there were demands that it's against the principles of Islam itself, that Hajj pilgrimage should be done with the means or the finances which one has at our own disposal.
So now the government is not supporting Muslim.
Sir, exact situation as of today I am not aware of, but there was demand, and I think government.
Christians?
Sir, congregational gathering I am not aware of, sir, exactly.
Uh-huh. So it's a preferential treatment sort of situation. Am I right in saying that?
No, sir. I would beg to differ, sir, because again, although I am not aware of the congregational gatherings which government supports in Christians, but the state supports the religious tenets and religious freedoms of Christians, as well as the financially also the support is there.
You see, you must have read the newspapers that such a pilgrimage should be for a pious cause. But it is being used for political reasons. Then how far you justify the use of the government resources for organization of such an event?
Yes. Sir, as long as it is For
you are income tax commissioner.
Yes.
And how would you react to that?
Sir, like as a common man as well as from as an income tax person, our resources should be judiciously used. As I said earlier, sir, also that as long as it is judicially used and as long as there is no political motive or political capitalization of the event as such, then it is not questionable as such.
That's an ideal situation.
Yes.
But what we are seeing, what we are reading, what we are hearing in newspapers, it's to the contrary. How do we react? Is it right or is it not right? You have to take a position.
Sir, political capitalization of event is wrong. But having said that, sir, politics is also part of society. So we need to empower our society so much so that the societies themselves, all the people of society should understand the rationale and the real motive behind any event or real motive behind any popular, any political motive behind it. So if people are aware, people are politically educated, then the political parties will not have any incentive to...
You are still avoiding my question. You are not taking a position with whether resources should be utilized or are being utilized correctly or they should not be utilized.
Sir, resources should be utilized because our constitution provides for the same. They should be judiciously utilized. Because every penny of our revenue has to be used for constructive activities, and religion itself is one of the constructive activities because it inculcates the spirit of tolerance, inculcates spirit of harmony. So as long as it's not one against the other, sir, it's perfectly justifiable, sir.
Mr. Robert Madeira, and ST Minister of Haryana. They are embroiled in a controversy. Legally, they are facing actions. What is that?
Sorry, sir,
CBI has registered cases against Robert Vadera and ST Minister Huda. It is relating to what matters. Criminal cases have been filed against them.
Sorry, sir, but I am not
no
aware.
Idea.
Exactly, I am not aware.
It has to be with the land, let me give you a little hint. It has to do something with the land. Which land, how, and why?
Sorry, sir.
About this Rafael deal, what do you think, any underhand dealings was there or it is a clear deal?
Sir, it's actually still in the scrutiny, so it would be inappropriate to comment on the same, sir.
What are the highlights of the new budget which has been just announced?
Sir, budget has proposed some schemes like a PM Kisan, wherein the income support will be provided to farmers who have less than 2 hectares of land holding for rupees 6,000 in 3 installments. One is the pension support to the workers of unorganized sectors. The tax relief provided to people earning less than 5 lakh rupees in the form of rebate. And some tax relief provided to real estate sectors.
As a student of sociology, what do you think are the main social issues confronting our country today?
Patriarchy, casteism, communalism, lack of adequate channelization of youth energy into constructive activities, regionalism.
And what role do you think the state should play, I mean, in the resolution of, say, social issues? For example, recently there has been a judgment on triple talaq. So there have been both sorts of views. Right, that the government or the judiciary should not have intervened, left it to the community. So what's your take on that?
Sir, social change has to be a two-way process, sir. On the one hand, government as well as judiciary has active role to play in any social reform. At the same time, doing it top-down is not desirable in the longer terms, because social change has to keep pace with social psyche and social situations in the time, sir. So in that way, sir, we have to bring educational as well as psychological change among the mindsets of people at large. So the change has to be brought from both ends. Only then it will be effective, sir. So in that way, sir, education, employment and awareness of self-actualization are very much required in all the sections of society, so that the progressive changes are accepted by populations.
Specifically on the, do you agree with the criminalization of triple talaq?
Sir, as far as criminalization is concerned, it's a debatable issue. Because although the motive is genuine and appreciable, but criminalization can be reconsidered, because it would hurt the sentiments of minority population, and on the other hand, it's a bit harsh to some extent, sir.
Recently, there was this American missionary tourist who was attacked and killed by a Sentinelese.
Yes.
Right. So, what's your take as a social scientist, as a student of society, how should we approach tribal development, particularly, say, those in the Andamans? Please.
Sir, tribals have to be brought into mainstream, but at the pace and at the levels which tribals themselves want. Because we can't and we should not impose the level of development which we treat as development, because what we treat as development might not be desirable on the part of tribals. So they have their distinct way of life which they cherish, and they should be allowed to do that without, but at the same time it should be a judicious mix of empowering them in whatever way they want.
So if you come to the specifics of the Sentinelese, what do you suggest should be our approach to that? This approach of the state?
Sir, as far as health, as far as basic aspects of sanitation, hygiene are concerned, the state can have minimum amount of interaction and interference in their lives only, and that too with bringing them into confidence by gradual level of interaction and keeping their rituals, their sentiments and their way of life distinct as they want. So it should be a only limited but gradual interactions.
One last question. What's your take on the LGBT rights movement? Right, recently section 377 has been decriminalized, has been watered down. So do you think, for example, next gay marriage should be legalized? Are we ready for that?
Sir, again, social change has to be gradual, and gradually we are moving towards it. And human rights, we as a society should refrain from imposing what is natural and what is unnatural on an individual choice. So as long as individuals treat as fair enough, and if it's not harming any other sections of society, then that is that should be allowable in their personal lives.
You know, critics fear, for example, that such judgments like the striking or watering down of section 377, it can lead to a potential spread of homosexuality. And so do you agree with that? What's your take?
Sir, our society is resilient enough to prevent prevalence of homosexuality, or for that matter any kind of drastic social change. But if people themselves have natural inclinations towards particular sexuality, then it is equally undesirable on the part of society to impose our views on them and suppress them both physically as well as psychologically. So we should be open enough as a society to accept whatever changes are occurring in the world as well as in our societies.
That's all right from
me. We have another few more minutes. If there are any more questions, please.
Okay. What is withholding tax?
Sir, withholding, whenever there is payment to be made to this, I'm just confused, sir. If foreign entities are paying to Indian entity, or when Indian entity is paying to
foreign entities, paying to Indian entity.
Yes, that I was just confused.
Okay.
What
is ELSS?
Sorry, sir, I'm not aware.
Okay, have you heard of SIP?
No, sir.
SIP contract? Do you know about mutual funds?
Vague idea, sir. I am not deeply aware of it, sir.
Okay. Don't you save taxes yourself?
Yes, sir. Insurance policies I have.
Okay. And you know the investment mutual funds?
Sir, as of now, I don't have so much savings to invest. So, as of now, not.
Okay. My income is 8 lakh per annum. Personal income?
Yes, sir.
And I'm a professional. So, how would I save maximum number of taxes?
Sir, with the recent changes,
yes.
Up to 6.5 lakhs, the tax liability will be zero.
Okay.
If you invest 1.5 lakhs in mutual funds, insurance, and specific
mutual funds to buy an legal investment.
Sir, specifically, I'm not.
Okay, let's switch off. What is your take on this drama about this Brexit? What do you understand of this issue?
Sir, Britain had a referendum wherein it was passed that they want to leave European Union.
Mm.
But after that, there was deliberations between UK and European Union as to the procedures through which the exit will take place. Now there is no consensus in British Parliament as to there should be hard exit or soft exit, and a couple of contentious issues like Irish border, whether it should be kept as it is or it should be closed for trade and the movement of people. Then again, the contentious issue of...
It's okay. But why do you think the British want to leave European Union? What are their problems?
Migration. Unrestrained immigration is one. Then economically, some sections of British population believe that the relations with EU are straining their own resources. There are also the contentions that jobs are being taken away by people of European Union who are migrating to Britain. So these factors, as well as the independence which is being sought in foreign policy, as well as economic policies, these are all factors cumulatively led to a movement for Brexit, sir.
And how do you look at this movement for European integration? Formation of European Union. How has it done so far, and what are its prospects in the future?
Sir, with the harsh experience of World Wars, European countries sought to have united existence, mutual coexistence for peace and harmony, as well as economic give and take, economic prosperity. So in that way, sir, European Union has mixed experience in the way that there has been prosperity, but there have been challenges like the level and extent of expansion towards Eastern Europe, towards countries like Turkey, which some countries of European Union agree to and some disagree to. So it's a kind of friction going on. And in future, if European Union exists the way it is working, and it is a significant block which can provide an example to other countries to exist peacefully, sir.
But do you think this idea of countries coming together, forming groups and blocks, is it something desirable, it's good or not so good?
Sir, with the example of World Wars again, it is desirable that countries come together. Even if there is some disagreement, they can deliberate if they are together. For example, SAARC nations, sir, East Asian countries, their coexistence will definitely aid them because they are neighbors, they will be having problems. And as long as there are deliberations, those problems can be discussed. And if and that can reduce mutual hostilities. But at the same time, sir, these blocs should not come into the world trade, wherein the world free world trade should not get hampered by the mutual antagonism of blocs in themselves. So, as long as there is a balance of the two, it is desirable.
Good. Thanks. Well done, 30 minutes. Okay. So, you can wait for 5 minutes then.
Yes, sir.